evening, everyone. This is third to the series of webinars to be conducted by AnthraWeb and Bombay Industries Association. It is a pleasure to see a huge participation from you all. Today's webinar is being conducted by Chartered Accountant Annapurna Srikant. She is a Chartered Accountant in Mysore, practicing since last 12 years, handling direct and indirect taxes, audit, consultation and litigation. This is our second in series webinar with her. She was also the Vice Chairman of State GST Committee, FKCCI, for the year 2018-19. She is Co-Chairman, Chairperson of Women Entrepreneur Committee, FKCCI, for the year 2019-20. She is an empaneled member in the Faculty of Indirect Taxes Committee of ICAI. She is a sought-after person at various professional forums and for government in conducting training programs for practitioners, trade and officers. We welcome you, ma'am. With this, I would like to hand over. Before that, I would just like to set the ground rules. I would, let the webinar continue, and the question answers will be at the end of the session. In the meanwhile, all of you all can put your questions or queries, whatever you have, in the Q&A segment of the Zoom. It is right over there. You can put your questions out there. So we will try and attend all those questions at the end of the sessions. So over to you, ma'am.
Yeah. Thank you so much. So this is, as he rightly said, it's the second series, AnthraWeb has taken up, so that some light can be thrown on practical aspects of using effectively the tally package for GST compliances. So today we have chosen a topic called tally voucher types relevant for GST. So come GST, there is a lot of changes in the requirement from the perspective of law as well, be it the type of invoice or voucher that needs to be raised under the law, or maintenance of books of accounts in a designated manner. So all these things have undergone quite a bit of changes post the GST implementation. So we thought of this would be a very handy and useful topic, so that people can practically implement these things in their day-to-day accounting course, and so that there can be GST compliance, any penal consequences can be avoided at a later point in time. So with this perspective, we've put across this topic on the board. And we would be, looking through this session. Like, first we will understand the legal requirements as per the GST law. Then we will practically sneak into the, how we can use tally to configure these requirements and, various voucher types which would be required to be used. How effectively it can be used, and so that entire documentation, whatever is required from the law perspective, it's all available at one place in tally. We need not search for an Excel file or a Word file or a printed document within our stored in our physical files. Rather than juggling through all of this, it would definitely make good sense to, in fact, consolidate all the documentation requirement right in the integrated software, whatever we use, so that whenever we want, we get the access at one place or one point in time. So we will, try and understand how we can configure the various voucher types in tally so that appropriately those transactions can get recorded. It can facilitate easy two-way reconciliation, which is a critical aspect for my input tax credits claim, especially after October 2019, when this matching has been made mandatory, and only post-matching with a small leverage of either 20% up to December or post that 10% is available. Of course, during this COVID times, they have provided a relaxation that we can do a two-way reconciliation on a cumulative basis from February to August. But all said and done, to do a reconciliation, I have to get the data in a structured manner so that it can, we can do away the manual reconciliation mechanism and use some techniques and tools through which we can do it. So All this requires appropriate configuration of the data and appropriate accounting, because software is a software, garbage in, garbage out. If we do not understand how to use it, then no matter whatever is there in the software, it might not give the end result as it is required. So with these perspective in mind, we have put across today's session. I'll also be taking you through passing of the actual transactions once these voucher types have been configured, and how do we manage with the output as well, even in respect of print. We can do certain configurations. I've seen during audits that they miss out giving some print configurations, and there will be a whole lot of issues which might come up during assessment. So let us dwell all through this in today's session. First, let me take you, as per the GST law, what are the various vouchers or records or type of documents which are required to be maintained, and then we will see at least a few of these I'll be demonstrating today as to how we can incorporate these things in Tally itself. I know most common is this tax invoice. Whenever we are making a taxable supply, that is a supply where there is a GST rate envisaged for it, be it 5%, 10%, 12%, 18%, 28%, 3%, whatever the rate be. If there is a tax rate for a supply, and if a supply is taxable, then we call it as a taxable supply. And whenever there is a taxable supply, be it goods or be it services, we need to issue something called as tax invoice. This is mandatory, and we also have what all should be part of this tax invoice. That is why I've given the section and rule reference, so that if somebody is interested to note that, then they can definitely run through that content and have a look at it. Okay, my tax invoice, does it encompass all these fields which the law has specified? We can definitely do a cross check. Better late than never. If we have missed out on certain aspects, definitely we can implement it, correct it henceforth, so that we can go in for a forward thinking process, so that at least from today onwards, or as and when we implement the corrections, we can try to be more compliant. So I will be taking through that as and when I will be dwelling with respect to this particular invoice type. Now, there is another voucher type which has been specified under the law, which is called as revised invoice. One must not confuse this, because once a tax invoice is issued, let's say there is an error in the tax invoice, either with respect to rate or taxable value, then the only way to rectify it is either issue credit note or debit note as per the provisions of the law. In fact, there are the three instances have been prescribed under the law where credit notes can be issued. One is return of goods. Second is deficiency in the quality of services, or if there is a discount which has been agreed beforehand, and a discount is to be issued post compliance of certain conditions. We have this turnover discount schemes and all that. So those things also can be effected through credit note. On the other hand, let's say the actual contracted transaction was for 12 lakh rupees, and the invoice was raised for 13 lakh rupees. So that being the case, there is a reduction in the value which is required. So that can be effected only through a credit note. We cannot cancel that invoice, or we cannot rewrite the same invoice. Revision of that invoice already issued is not permitted. The adjustment has to be effected through credit note or debit note. However, only in one instance, the law permits to issue a revised invoice. Now, what is that? I'll give you an example so that you can connect and understand it appropriately. Let's say I am a businessman. I am dealing with a certain, trading items. I purchase certain products and sell it. So I have recently started my business. Let's assume that. So I just don't want to get into this registration till my threshold limit has reached. Let's presume for time being that on 1st of May, my threshold of 20 lakh rupees or 40 lakh rupees, whatever, in certain states, wherever it has been accepted, it has crossed. So the trading turnover has crossed for 20 lakh rupees. Let's keep that as example for time being. Now, what does the law require? within 30 days of the completion of that threshold limit, I need to apply for registration. Now, I can't wait or stop doing business till I get my registration certificate. Now, I'll be in a dilemma. Since I've crossed 20 lakh rupees, should I collect tax from the customer or not? Should I raise an invoice, tax invoice? If I have to raise a tax invoice, what GST number will I put in? Because I have not yet got the GST registration number. So to do away with all these confusions or clarifications, so government has provided for something called as revised invoice. For time being, we can issue an invoice without specifying the GST number because we don't know our GST number and we have just applied for it. It might take a week's time or a 15 days time, whatever it be. So once that registration number is received, I can incorporate that registration number and issue a revised invoice. Only for this purpose of new registration, revised invoice is permitted. That too to specify the GST number, not to alter any figures which have been already there. So any alterations or adjustments has to be routed through credit note and debit note. Then in case of, let's say, we have a cinema hall or a movie theater where the let's think for time being that it's not a multiplex, but it is a regular cinema hall, the conventional cinema hall. And let's say the ticket price is 150 rupees. So there are, let's say, in a one show, there are 200 people who watch that movie. So does it mean to say that I have to issue, you know, a tax invoice with the entire details present therein to each of the person? The law provides that wherever the value is below 200 rupees per transaction and the person is an unregistered person, then one can issue a consolidated tax invoice day-wise, clubbing the entire day's transaction into one. The condition is it should be below 200 per transaction and the person is unregistered. So these conditions are met, one can even issue something called as consolidated tax invoice day-wise. Now, let's say I have a product which is exempt. I'll take a classic example of a medical store, you know, the medicine store we have. There, let's say it's a medical store deals with the B2B transactions as well as B2C. So there is some walk-in customers who come and buy the medicines, plus the medical store supplies to retailers who further supply, those medicines. Now, out of the 10 items for which a, you know, order has been received, there are 8 products which are taxable and 2 products which are exempt. So how should we issue a document? The answer is, it depends on who is the customer. Let's say he is a registered vendor, a retailer to whom you are supplying. Then you have to issue 2 documents, one a tax invoice, another one a bill of supply. Tax invoice for taxable goods, bill of supply for exempt supplies. Alternatively, let's say he's a walk-in customer, he's unregistered, he buys, you know, 8 items, out of which 6 items are taxable, 2 items are exempt. You can issue something called as invoice cum bill of supply, because rules 46A was introduced to, you know, do away with this, compliance, complexity or enhancement of compliance burden. To avoid this, rule 46A was introduced, where if your customer is an unregistered person, then in a single document called invoice cum bill of supply, you can issue you can sell both the goods and put both of things in the same document. But if your customer is registered, then you have to segregate the products, and for taxable items, you have to issue tax invoice, and for exempt items, you have to issue bill of supply. So similarly, there is a concept called consolidated bill of supply. In fact, even composition registered persons are required to issue bill of supply, a separate bill of supply with certain specifications. I'll be taking you through all of these during today's session. Now, we also have something called as GST receipt voucher. I have specifically used the word GST receipt voucher. This is not the accounting receipt voucher. Accounting receipt voucher is any amount I received, whether through cash mode or bank mode or any, whatever the wallet mode, everything we pass a receipt entry. That is an accounting receipt voucher. But I'm talking about GST receipt voucher. This needs to be issued whenever I receive advance towards a taxable supply. So in case of goods, it has been done away with effect from 15th of November 2017. The advances received with respect to goods, I need not discharge tax on advance. I can discharge only at the time of actual supply. But with respect to services, let's say there is a consultation service which I am providing and the customer gives me advance of let's say 10,000 rupees. So if I receive that money today, then I'll have to raise a GST receipt voucher and discharge taxes based on the amount received itself. So I will have to raise something called as a GST receipt voucher with all the designated details. Similarly, there is something called as GST refund voucher. Let's say we had a contract, but that consultation arrangement got cancelled and I'm refunding that voucher, that amount of 10,000, whatever I received. So I need to issue something called as GST refund voucher and I can reduce the tax, whatever I already discharged in my current liability. Then we have a very, very important and missed out aspect, which is called self-tax invoice. All of us, I'm sure many of us have started understanding how this reverse charge mechanism works and also, you know, various categories under which reverse charge is applicable, the GTA services, the legal services, the security services, even the hiring of the vehicle services, all these, you know, day in, day out, the number of transactions getting covered under the reverse charge mechanism is increasing. Is it merely sufficient that I just report it in my returns under my 3.1D of 3B, where I discharge my taxes, mentioning my liabilities there, and 4A3 of 3B, where I report the eligible ITC with respect to reverse charge? Is it sufficient if I just report there, or is there a documentation requirement under the law? The law prescribes that every credit claim document, like whatever credits you claim, it has to be substantiated by a credit claim supporting document. In case of a forward charge, we will have the tax invoices of the supplier, which we will be maintaining as a file. In case of imports, we will have bill of entry, where we will have IGST paid being recorded there. In case of a debit note or, you know, in case of a supplementary invoice, again, we will have that particular document. So all these cases, we will have those particular documents for claiming the credit. Now, whatever reverse charge, tax discharged. In that case, there is something called a self-tax invoice, which one needs to raise as a recipient. So if you are paying taxes, you know, as a recipient, as a recipient of that services, then you are required to raise this self-tax invoice. This is the most casually taken, or either lack of knowledge, or people are not just complying with this. So we have a thought of a method in how we can use Tally itself to create these types of vouchers, because there are practical challenges associated with this. The reason being, I would have, in the normal course of transactions, I would have already passed my entries, posting effects would have happened. But now if I pass another or create another voucher, then it might lead to double posting effect. So we are trying to explore a feature in Tally using which we can maintain this document in the Tally itself. Similarly, we have something called as GST payment voucher. Again, please don't get confused with respect to this accounting payment vouchers. Accounting payment vouchers is in the normal course, like whatever, if you use the Tally option of the payment voucher in the Tally, I think F5, you will actually, any vouchers passed will be accounting payment vouchers. But the GST law specifies that whenever you make RCM related payment, let's say you have you are obtaining from a logistics company registered, the VRL logistics, let's take for example. So you make some payments to them, you need to raise something called as GST payment vouchers. Let's take another example. There is a lawyer and you have hired him for some consultation charges. That is also under RCM. You are making some payment for him. So whatever payments are in the course of RCM related transactions, you need to raise something called as GST payment vouchers. I'm not highlighting the section number and the rule number. It is already displayed. You may just note it down for if need be, but I'm just trying to explain you the concept of where it is required. This again is most not diligently followed thing. If you look at GSTR 1 return, Table 13 of GSTR1 requires reporting of all the series of these vouchers. So, so that being the case, one needs to have configured these things and extract appropriate information and report appropriately in the designated segment of the return. Similarly, as I already explained, credit note is issued only under three circumstances provided in the law: return of goods, deficiency in the quality of goods or services, and reduction either in the taxable value or in the tax rate. Let's say I wrongly selected 18% rate when the actual rate was 12%. So I may issue a credit note in this regard. Similarly, a debit note, I charge less tax rate or I charge less value. So to enhance the value of my transaction or tax, the differential effect, I will use a debit note, or it is even a supplementary invoice is also treated as a debit note from the GST law perspective. Now coming to the delivery challan, whenever goods move for purposes other than supply, you might have a client, he might have requested, I want to have a look at the product once. Kindly send the product on approval basis, and only if I'm satisfied, I will keep it, or otherwise I'll return it back. So how will you move the goods? Whenever goods are moving for reasons other than supply, it has to be through a delivery challan. There could be an exhibition where you want to exhibit your products. Again, a delivery challan would be required. So likewise, there are various vouchers which are required as per the GST law. Now let us get into the practical side of it. We have this gateway of Tally where we can create these voucher types. You know, in case of a tax invoice, we will be configuring the voucher as sales. This is very basic. I'm sure all of you would have done it. Just as a coverage part, I just want to take you through all this. And if we want to use the advanced configuration, we will use this. And any particular series we want to use every year, we want to use a fresh series, let's say for this year, 2021, you can do the series, and always prefer to have an automatic, you know, voucher number series so that duplication will be avoided. And very important, we have to use the voucher number series only of the permitted characters. It will allow alpha, numeric, and a slash, backslash, and a hyphen. Otherwise, if you configure using any other, let's say star or, you know, the asterisk or hash or something, if you use, those are not allowed in the GSTN portal, and you will have the validation issues. And you will have to have some series here. You would have issued some series to customer. All that hodgepodge thing happens. So better be clear with what the law requires and what are the permitted characters, and use only those characters for the invoice series so that your sailing through GST compliance can be really smooth. Now, once you create a voucher type, if you select F8 in the voucher entry screen where you want to post a sales entry, at that time, you get the display like this. Whatever voucher types you have created, you get a display of all of that. And appropriate voucher type you can select. But remember, whenever you are using any voucher type for the sales related configuration, the underlying configuration you will be using as sales, so that all the related things will get captured there. Only thing is, we want the title as may be required for our convenience sake. So we are using these things. So once we have, we get the tax invoice being displayed here, and this is how we just record a transaction. And as I was telling, Rule 46 prescribes these 17 fields which should be present in the tax invoice. I'm sure most of it would be available, and some of them are automatically, you know, available in Tally. There is no need to configure at that print screen as well. So again, if I want to highlight what are the missed out things, one is place of supply. Kindly enable place of supply while printing. It is a legal requirement to print place of supply, especially if it is in the course of interstate trade or commerce. So if you are, you might be entering that, but at the time of printing, you have not enabled that, then you will be violating the provisions of the law. And in fact, there are certain circulars. I'll share it with you as to what are the penal consequences of not reporting this information. And also whether reverse charge. Every tax invoice should have a column or a place called whether reverse charge, whether the transaction is covered under reverse charge, yes or no. In most cases, it might be no. But if the service provider falls under a category where the transaction is under reverse charge, let's take a logistics company providing the goods transport services. So then they might be requiring to enable this as whether reverse charge, yes. So, but that field should be actually present in that invoice. So it is very important. As I was telling, there is this circulars requirement. In fact, subrule 2 of rule 36, what is this? Whenever I claim a input tax credit, as I already said that I should have a proper tax invoice in my hand. Now, what is a proper tax invoice? Initially, they said it should contain all the fields. So it is like the 17 fields. Then practically, there were so many instances where all fields were not present. Then they said that they brought in a proviso to the rule telling that, okay, fine. If all the fields in the tax invoice are not present, but these 7 fields are present, then also it will be treated as a valid invoice for credit claim. What are these 7 fields? One is amount of tax charged, description of the goods, the total value of the goods or services, GST of the supplier, GST of the recipient, and place of supply in case of interstate supplies. So these are the fields which are required to be present if one has to claim the credit. Otherwise, tomorrow department can review the documents and say that all are present, but these one of the details are not present, so we cannot allow this credit. These things are possible. I'm sure like this is a procedural issue, and if we go on to the litigation route, definitely we can fight it out. But as a business, definitely everybody will think of buying peace and doing things in a simpler manner, so that a business should be focusing on the business matters and not on the litigation matters. So that being the case, always compliance will be the key per se, and these fields has to be very critically ensured that once an invoice is received from issued by your supplier and you receive the same, maybe the team who does the accounting can be trained that let there be a check and measure of appropriately checking whether all these fields have come into that invoice or not. Otherwise, you might require your supplier to issue an appropriate invoice containing all the fields. So I think this is a check which can be inserted at the entry level itself. So I was talking about 2 circulars. One is circular 89, which says that in case of interstate supplies to consumers, that is unregistered persons, in GSTR 3B, we need to report table 3.2. Of course, if you have configured it in Tally, it automatically picks up that data based on the state of supply, place of supply. It even reports state-wise information consolidation. All that is there. But if you miss out configuring it appropriately in Tally, then it can attract a penal consequences under Section 125, which can extend to up to about 25,000 penalty under CGST law, SGST law, and even IGST law for that matter. So this is, they have clarified that filling details of 3.2 table of GST is very important, which is nothing but what supplies made out the state to B2C customers. That state-wise reporting is required. Now, I'll also give you the background why the government requires this information. Whatever is in the IGST mode, it has to again get divided between center and state. If it is not reported as to...
Yeah, Annapurna, there is a... The voice is cracking.
Not opposed to that. Balance start get accumulating in the IGST ledger itself. So it clearly,
Can you please check? The voice is cracking. It's
Is it okay? Yeah, just give me a minute.
Yeah, sure.
Hello?
Yeah.
Is it better now?
Yeah, it is better now. Yes, yes.
It's better. Okay. Yeah. So the point I was trying to make out was, as per the circular, printing place of supply or issuing an invoice with place of supply is very, very critical. and required again, otherwise it can attract penalty under provisions 122 or 125, which is again in case of 122 it is 10,000 CGST, 10,000 SGST, and 125 it is 25,000. So I'm just trying to highlight that how critical is to configure certain fields in Tally or whatever software you use for that matter for the purpose of raising the tax invoice. Now, how do we do this? In fact, before printing, we have an option of configuring the further printing options. So once we get this field, there are so many details which are there. Whatever is highlighted as yes, these are the more or less the mandatory fields which would be required. If you look at here, there is this place of supply and we have highlighted as yes here because we want that to be displayed. So on and also we have further in fact descriptions where we want to print all the declaration, like we may have put in like whether reverse charge yes or no under declaration so that it will become part of our invoice. So now since I've configured it, I can see that in the print mode place of supply has been displayed here. So likewise, it is important to configure all the 17 fields as in whatever is applicable in this instance. Now going to this bill of supply. Now this bill of supply is, I can say that there are five varieties in this bill of supply. One is a regular registered person making a exempt supply. As I already explained in that pharma case, where if he's supplying to a retailer, then he is registered person. So I have to issue a separate document called bill of supply. Then we have this composition registered person, 1%, 5% scheme. He is also required to issue, the most commonly the hoteliers would have opted for this. And we also have a recent scheme of a below 50 lakhs, up to 50 lakhs. If B2C transactions are there, this scheme is also very much viable. And especially for the chowdhuries and all that, where the income is up to 50 lakh rupees per year. So it's like a 6% composition rate is available so that other party anyways cannot claim credit out of it. So we have these schemes. And also, as I already discussed, again, if it is a retail, if it is a B2C customer, I can issue a single document called invoice cum bill of supply and be done with it. So these are the fields which are required in the bill of supply. Again, we can use this voucher type, create something called as bill of supply under sales. And then we can, use this module for wherever there is the exempt supplies. Now, in fact, in case if we have an FD interest, we call it as an exempt supply because it is use of money. Bank is using our money and it is giving us interest that gets covered as services. And however, there is exemption with respect to that. So we need to raise a bill of supply even with respect to FD interest received. We should also ensure that TDS has been grossed up because bank could have deducted the TDS and deposited the balance. So all these things needs to be taken care. Once we configure, we get this voucher as bill of supply. Now here is a bill of supply for composition registered person. So here it should display that composition taxable person not eligible to collect tax on supplies. This is a requirement of the law. Now how do we do this? There is a option called titling. If we use this titling, we can put whatever option is required as a subtitle. So that will get displayed there. So in case of this 6% scheme, the notification requires us to print this on every bill of supply issue. So if we configure it as subtitle in the titling option, that gets displayed here and thus we can do the compliance. Invoice cum bill of supply, again, I can create that voucher type in the sales itself. Same procedure, but just while passing the transaction, I can select as invoice cum bill of supply. So it will get displayed like the same title, whatever we give here. And I can record both taxable as well as exempt in the same voucher. Now, as I was referring to the self-invoice, I said that whenever a person is having an RCM transaction, one has to make sure that they have a self-invoice. But if your vendor is registered, he would himself issue something called as a reverse charge tax invoice. At that time, you need not have a self-invoice. Only if you're dealing with an unregistered vendor and RCM is applicable, in such a case, self-tax invoice would be required. As I was already discussing, it will lead to a double posting effect because once you would have already, let's say the carriage inwards, you would have booked it, let's say it is 5,000 rupees and you've paid the freight charges, you would have already booked the transactions in the normal course. Now, if you post something, one more extra entry called self-invoice, then it might lead to a situation of double posting and your balances can get AOI. So I don't want that to happen. So what we can do is, there is an option called make this voucher type as optional by default. So we can enable this and make this voucher as optional so that it will not have posting effect, but it will have only the effect of having this document within our tally system itself. So once we select that, we get something called as an optional voucher displayed here. So I have used this local transportation RCM here. So that is why, there is in fact, the RCM requirement which comes in. So in fact, we can even issue a consolidated self-invoice for a 9-4 transaction. Now, what is this 9-4 transaction? I don't want to make it too technical. Real estate sector, has been brought in with this reverse charge mechanism for any procurements from unregistered persons with effect from 1/4/2019. Otherwise, earlier it was there from 1st July to 13th October only. So, but since 1st April 2019, real estate sector got this additional compliance requirement. So this might be helpful for them for raising a consolidated monthly one self-invoice for all their RCM transactions from the unregistered suppliers. So again, I was talking about the GST payment vouchers to be made for the these RCM compliances. Again, we create a voucher type. Here, we will create it as a payment voucher, but we will provide the configuration as a purchase because we want various fields. As you can see, the payment voucher has all these information to be present there. So we can use the existing feature of Tally, configure it as purchases, and very important, make it as optional voucher so that it will not have a posting effect. And then once you try to make a transaction, you get this here. So again, it will get displayed as an optional voucher. Now, how do we view this optional vouchers? We can go to display exception reports and optional vouchers, and we get the number of transactions. So this is a payment voucher. We have given one series. This we can extract and report it in our GSTR1 and do the necessary compliances. So I would suggest that we can actually take up the precautions, and preventives are always better than cure. And having everything at one place is always the key. We need to automate so that manually, otherwise maintaining in Excel, we don't know which staff, who did, where is it lying, which folder, which file, all these issues we will have. And it's better, it's all integrated and available at one place of whatever we, transact with, so that it's a one point access, and comparison will also be very much helpful whenever doing the yearly reconciliations and all that process. So appropriate knowledge and upskilling and training oneself can also go a long way, because many a times, although we intend to do the compliances, sometimes because of the lack of knowledge or things like the as the aspects, in fact, it's just not known that we need to do this. Sometimes things are missed out because of these reasons. Now I also want to add one more point here. In fact, if we purchase a fixed asset, we can also configure a voucher type called fixed asset purchase voucher, so that we can use that. And one must not confuse that just because we configure that voucher under purchase type, it will not move into my purchase ledger. I understand a fixed asset purchase should come in the balance sheet under the fixed assets schedule, and not under the purchases in the trading schedule. So that being the case, we are only using the voucher types and not the groups. Whenever we are using groups, it is as good as like we will use computer grouped under fixed assets. But only while making the transaction entry, we will use something called as the fixed asset purchase voucher type, so that will travel to my ITC register. And whenever I'm claiming the credit and doing a comparison thereof, I can actually do the requisite comparisons, and it will facilitate easy two-way reconciliation, plus the requirement of the ITC register to be maintained can also be fulfilled. So I think we can definitely take up the questions if the audience have any specific questions. the floor is open for the question session.
Yeah, thank you, Annapurna. I would like to take some questions from the QA section at the moment.
Yeah.
Yeah. So there is a question from Shilpa. How to rectify invoice for wrong HSN code?
See, in fact, technically, once issued, as per the law requirement states, there is no concept called a revised invoice for these kinds of errors. See, if the only option is we need to cancel that invoice and issue a appropriate invoice if it is, you know, identified at the early stage itself.
Okay.
That is the only way through.
So you have to take care before.
Yeah.
So there is one question from Mr. Bala Subramaniam, whether tax invoice and bill of supply invoice serial number should be different.
The validation happens year wise, year level. I mean, for the same year, you cannot repeat that number. So it is a year wise unique number which you should give. And in case of bill of supply, since in the GSTR-1, you will be reporting it under Table 8 on a consolidated basis, you can issue the same number, but for you, from the control perspective, it might be difficult for you to keep a track of this number, whether it's a tax invoice. Again, you have to go it into the contents and check it out. So from the law perspective, it's like there is no restriction I see here, but from the practical perspective, it is better to have a separate series. You can have TI-1 onwards as tax invoice, BS-1 onwards as bill of supply. That indicative, it is indicative also. It's easily identifiable. Yeah.
There's one question which is related to ITC register. Can you get tally?
If everything is appropriately configured, then the data will flow into the return section. GSTR-TB, we have table 4 where all the content and invoice-wise details will be available in GSTR-3B statutory reports division. So from there, you can extract the ITC register appropriately. Else, you will have to go to the duties and taxes segment and extract the details. Otherwise, we have a lot of add-on tools which can extract the ITC register, because many a times we see that some are recorded as purchase vouchers, some are recorded as journal entries. All these challenges are there, and that being the case, some payment vouchers itself, even those transactions are also accommodated. We see multiple practices prevailing over there, so we can use a tool to extract purchase register in such a case. So these are the possibilities how we can get the ITC register out of tally.
There is a question related to cash discount, whether we should use credit note for that, or what is the
See, in fact, if we look at the discount perspective, section 15 states that most of the generally how the trade contractual terms works out with respect to this cash discount is, if you pay within a designated time, then you get a discount of cash. So there is a condition attached to this giving discount. Only if that condition is fulfilled, then this discount is given. It squarely fits into the provision of section 15, section 3, provides that a post sale discount can be effected. And we can issue a credit note, but there are certain conditions. That one is, we need to link it to the invoice number for which that cash discount is allowed. Plus, the other party should have reversed that credit. So this is the challenge. How do we identify whether that customer to whom we issued credit note, he has, reversed the credit which he has claimed? This is a practical challenge, but yes. For your question whether we can issue credit note for cash discount, the answer is yes.
So will that be available in ITC register? It will.
Yeah. See, once you issue a credit note, if the credit note under GST law can be issued only by the supplier. Okay. So that credit note will be recorded by the recipient as an accounting debit note. Okay. Because both credit notes and debit notes under GST law can be issued only to the supplier. Recipient can only record that transaction. So what happens, you think from, let's say, Antraweb is the supplier. Myself, I am the recipient. Okay. So I transacted with some transaction with Antraweb. And since I made a prompt payment, you have offered me a cash discount. Now you will issue a credit note for me. Let's take the example. Let's say it's 1 lakh rupees, and 18,000 is the ITC, and 10,000 is the cash discount given. Let's just keep those round figures for example's sake. So there is a requirement for me to reverse the 1,800 rupees. Okay, how will I record this? There is this regular accounting debit note through which I will record this. Supplier issued credit note that will go to the effect of ITC ledger in the credit side of the ITC ledger, that is reduce the ITCs.
Okay. So
definitely in that option is already there, where once we record a credit note issued by the supplier, that will go and reduce my ITC values. I mean, the net effect in that ledger, we can see that there is a recording in the opposite direction, so that net effect is after reducing that credit note.
That's it. What do you suggest the voucher type should be for paying commission to person registered or unregistered?
You can configure a tax invoice if you want to specifically mention it as a service. You can have tax invoice for services and raise a regular, configure it under sales type. And if I have to pay commission, okay, it is a payment of commission and not commission. And it all depends whether that person is registered under GST and is he collecting GST on that. If he is collecting that, then configure a voucher type as expense voucher under the category purchase, so that you can record all the ITC related information. Definitely commission paid will be an indirect expense, which you will be recording in tally. But the only thing is that will flow to the ITC register if he is registered under GST. If he is not registered, you can pass a regular expense booking entry. That is like either you can use a journal voucher as the particular expense, commission head debit and the party account credit. Again, party account debit and cash or bank credit. Those two transactions you can do it that way. But if it is a GST transaction, kindly use the voucher type as expense voucher configured as purchase.
I think there are a lot of requirement for recording of this session. So I would like to tell the recorded session will be available on Facebook and later on YouTube as well. Okay. So you can go to the Antraweb page of Facebook and you will find the recording out there. There is one more question. What about free schemes like product when you sell 1 over 10? Suppose 1 free for every 10. So how do you record that?
Yeah. See, in fact, post GST, especially we find this issue with the pharma industry. But now I think many of the industries have decided and come down to something called as the value discount module vis-a-vis the quantity discount module. See, I'll take an example again. Let's say I'll take the very same example or the question which they have put in. 10 plus 1. So if you buy 10 sheets of medicine, one sheet is free. So in fact, the first session we already discussed, in business, nothing is free. Nobody does anything in business for free. So I would say that you are getting 11 sheets of medicine at the price of 10. Embedded discount kind of a thing, that is what we call as quantity discount. There's a high risk of adopting this quantity discount module. If we say 10 sheets, I'll take an example. So each sheet, let's say it costs 10 rupees. So 10 sheets, it is 100 rupees. And I am giving one as free. I mention on the invoice 10 sheets, 10 into 10, 100. One sheet, 0, bracket free, then I'll charge only 18 rupees, I'm presuming 18%, 18 rupees GST on that, and 118 I'll charge. This is called as quantity discount model, a very risky model. It's very clear on the assessment side. They can say that there is a, you know, you have not charged GST on this, but you need to pay it, and they can ask for that GST. It's a risky module. I'll suggest what is an alternative and a better module. Same thing, we can incorporate this as volume value-based discount module. Nothing needs to be changed. No extra, nothing is required. We can say that the 11 sheets of medicine, 110 rupees, less discount 10 rupees, 100. On that charge 18 rupees and 100 net invoice value. Both the questions, only presentation you are changing and being very safe, because the GST law permits using discount on face value. I mean, on the face of the invoice, you can mention discount, and that can be allowed as a reduction from the taxable value, and it will be very safe route comparing it to the quantity discount module, which can be very risky. Net result is same, but only presentation in the invoice differs, which can be, which can lead to financial implications.
Ma'am, there is one why Mr. Ajay Dubey, if my billing address is Maharashtra with GST of Maharashtra, but place of supply is Delhi, can I claim GST on basis of billing address?
Yeah, absolutely. So there is, if my billing address is in Maharashtra with GST of Maharashtra, but place of supply is Delhi, can I claim GST on the basis of billing address? So I'm presuming that, it is a bill to ship to module where the billing address is Maharashtra and GST is Maharashtra, place of supply is Delhi.
So the consumption is in Delhi.
Where is the supplier? Can we take him on call?
Yeah, Ajay. Yes. Yeah, Ajay, you can speak. Yeah, Ajay, you have a question related to billing in Maharashtra and delivery in Delhi. I have enabled your mic. You can speak.
Or maybe we'll take this at the end if he comes back on the speak. Maybe you can drop him a private message on the chat as well.
Okay, fine. I think that would be good. Yeah.
Yeah.
There is one more related to bill to party and ship to party. Both locations are separate. So yeah. How do you tackle that in Tally? Maybe I think that is a question.
Yeah, I think there is already an option. Once you go to that voucher model, I think just give me a time. I will practically show them how we can do it. I think that will make more sense and people can understand that. Do we do that?
Yeah, that is fine. But there are a lot of questions. But that is a very normal.
You can enable billing address and customer address different, and we can actually, get that. Because some of the questions explaining theoretically, it will be a little,
Yes.
You can see my screen, I hope.
Yes.
So let's say we are doing a sales transaction, recording a sales transaction. Let's say I am going in for a bill of supply, whatever. So once I do this F12, we can, allow separate buyer and consignee names. If we then it will ask for whom should I bill to, and what is the consignee name, what is the, bill to ship to transactions. So I think that is how we can do this.
Right. There is one question from Hiral Solanki. At time where we receive the credit note from the party for cancellation of invoice, what shall be the voucher type in my books?
At time when we receive the credit note from the party for cancellation of invoice, what shall be the voucher type in my books? See, for cancelling an invoice, one cannot issue credit note. So that is not a permitted course in the law. In fact, there is a recent circular with respect to GST which states that if an advance is given and that did not happen, then one can issue a refund voucher. But with respect to this cancellation of invoice, I'm not sure if we can use a credit note per se. But it should come as a, I mean, in fact, we should, I mean, what is the reason for cancellation? It needs to be looked into. I mean, this cannot be answered on a general basis. We have to take this question on a more specific.
Yeah. I think we'll take the next one. Please share a tip for GSTR to reconciliation matching using Tally.
Yeah, I think you should be able to tell it better. I'm sure AntraWeb has come out with a lot of tools for reconciliation of.
So there are, see what happens is Tally, GST is a very wide subject, and as you rightly said, a lot of things are there which are like GSTR2 reminder or reconciliation, or when you have multiple branches across India and you want to maintain it in one company. So things get a lot of complication, and there are specific needs of specific people.
Yeah.
So that is where we have a lot of modules or add-ons which can actually help in streamlining all of this basically. So that's why there is a screen, there is tallyhelp.com. Please do raise a query out there, and we will come back to you on those things.
Even personalized tools can be built. And also there are some other tools which are available which can extract data from Tally and use the 2A, download it from the portal and do the reconciliations. Possible. We can also do it through Excel. Again, it will be a little cumbersome process and all that. I would suggest on using a customized tool so that I don't think 2A reconciliation should ever be thought about in doing in a manual way. It should always be automated. That's the key. Because monthly it is required and cumulative it is required. A lot of challenges with that. Always use tech support for two-way reconciliation.
Thanks. So there is a question. How many type of optional voucher can be generated?
How many ever you want. I mean, just keep it minimal as per the requirement. So I just showed you for self-invoice and GST payment vouchers, as we thought, since it should not have a posting effect. Wherever you do not want to have the posting effect for the transaction, you can use optional vouchers. Only if it is required, kindly use it. But there is no restriction per se as to how many number you can generate.
There is one question from Mr. Kanaya. Can we issue credit note to retailers pre-GST? Only basic amount credited, not tax.
See, we have, you can kindly refer Circular 72, which states that, after the September period, which is over, then what can be done? So, in case of pharma industry, they've provided that you can ask the actual recipient. Earlier, he was the purchaser. Now, you can ask him only to raise a supply invoice and you can treat it as a purchase transaction, because the credit note time limit is September of the following year. So that being the case, we can go for that option, or else you can use a without GST credit note. We call it as financial credit notes. So subject to that Circular 72, you can.
I think ideal question for you, when a chartered accountant provides any service to the clients, do we issue debit note or tax invoice?
See, it's like debit note is only when it is supplementary invoice, it is required to be used. Or like there is a transaction and there is enhancement in the value for that. That is when a debit note will come into picture. And ideally, the initial transaction should always be tax invoice. Only if there is escalation in the price owing to the pre-contractual terms, then only the question of debit note comes in.
Fine. How do you revise invoice in Tally? Or is it advisable to revise invoice, or better to
raise? As I said, revised invoice is only applicable for new registration. That too to record GST number once you get the registration certificate. Otherwise, the correct route is cancel that invoice and issue a proper invoice with a separate number and series.
There is a question from CA Ekta Parekh. He's asking, airway bill also new if old invoice is cancelled?
I did not get this question.
So I think is it really means like you raise a new airway bill if the old invoice is cancelled or something like that, or I didn't get the
Okay, the shipping bill, if they're talking about the shipping bill and the airware bill kind, whenever it is in case of exports, I think, you know, as far as shipping bill is concerned, I'm aware that there is a provision of, cancelling the shipping bill and using an actual shipping bill. Only that is why the validation happens for Gateway EG. That is the proof for final movement of goods outside the country. I mean, it is too technical to answer this question. Maybe we can take it offline if required.
Sure. There is one question. How do we handle the B2B client's data in Tally? Now, is it something to very, multiple?
Very pretty simple thing. While configuring your customer masters, you have to put in all the GST related information, the state, address, GST number, validated GST number, all that. So once that is put, whenever a record transaction is recorded using that client's GST number, automatically it will get configured as a B2B transaction. And if, I mean, that's what you have to enable, the GST related configurations in Tally. Once done, everything will flow into the respective return section using technology.
So there is a question from Subhash, Mr. Subhash Gawai. Suppose we have to goods return to the party, return goods to the party. What is better, credit note or sales invoice?
See, if you're returning goods, you can use a sales invoice. You have to move the goods to delivery challenge, and your supplier should raise a credit note. Once you receive that credit note, you will map that delivery challenge and account it as an accounting debit note. I know it's a little kind of three elements involved here, but this is how you have to do.
But does sales invoice is a better choice out there?
No, see, what is sales? If you are selling your product, it will be sales. What right. You purchased, you are returning, then it will be your purchase return. We right. Cannot equate purchase return to sales. Of course, after September, if owing to the legal provisions which facilitates to issue such, sales invoice instead of that purchase return, you are permitted to do so, but this will not become a practice otherwise. We should be accounting conventions and methodologies has to
be followed. Yeah,
tried and followed. Yeah.
There is one from Aditya. GST.
Yeah, maybe this we will take this as the last question.
Last question. I think we can. Yeah, yeah. So Aditya Vagheria, he is asking GST receipt voucher, which we have to make when we receive advance. Yeah. Has to be numbered in the series of a normal output invoice, or we should have a separate invoice for that?
No. Have a separate series, because reporting is also separately required and the voucher type is also separate. So have it as a separate series.
I think there are so many questions, but I would advise everyone. I think it has gone overboard. But I would advise people to raise their queries on www.tallyhelp.com. And we'll get back to you from there. Any things which we can solve it, we will try to resolve. But any expert guidance and all, basically, we'll forward that question.
Or if people are interested and if they are really willing to know these things, next time we can have exclusive Q&A session itself on this particular topic, where we can get all the answers to all the questions raised. Even we can do that.
Excellent.
Yeah.
But yeah, so it was an excellent session. I think, Annapurna, I think what I understand is the voucher types in Tally, the best way to have your entire implementation done in a very nice manner.
Exactly.
And you have shown it that way, that particular feature of Tally is so powerful. And I think we will have everything using the optional entry and creating different sub voucher types under the main voucher type. And to play around that, so that you have all the information out there under one place. So thank you so much for your expert guidance and all. I think people must have a lot of takeaways from here on. And we'll have one more session on this. If Q&A, I would request everyone, if Q&A is what you want, you can put it in the chat right now and say whether you want an exclusive QA and sessions.
So that can we put a poll? Can we put a poll now?
Yeah, I. It will be difficult to create a.
Okay, fine. Not a problem.
But I can just try. I think that can be much. Annapurna, thank you so much for your time and coming out here. And I think we'll have another session also, because long and very deep subject. And people would love to have more sessions on this. So thank you so much. And
thank
with
you.
This, I would
Pleasure
like to end the session. Okay, sure. Thank you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
कभी आने नहीं, बोला दिए। हाँ।